give him glory. We come to lift our hand and give him praise. We come to lift our hand and give him glory. We come to lift our hand and give him praise. Give him glory.
Glory, glory. Come to lift our hand and give him praise.
And give him praise. We come to lift our hands and give him glory. We come to lift our hands and give him praise. Everybody say,
we come to lift our hands and give him glory. We come to lift our hands and give him praise. We come to lift our hands.
Sing the praises to our King, for He is the King of Kings.
Jesus, who our King, for He is the King of Kings. We sing the praises to my King, for He is the King. We sing the praises to my King, for He is the King of Kings. We sing the praises to my King, for He is the King.
We sing the praises to my King, for He is the King of Kings. We sing the praises to my King, for He is the King. We sing the praises to the King, for He is the King of Kings. We sing the praises to our King, for He is the King. Praise Him.
I love praises Him. Yes to my Lord, because he's done great things. And I'm just going to say yes. Yes, yes to my Lord.
Yes, Lord.
I say yes to my Lord. I say yes to my Lord. He's done great things. He's done great things.
Great thing, I'll say yes, yes, yes to my Lord.
Hey.
Same thing for you. Now I'm going to act like you have some Holy Ghost. I'm going to say that again. You're going to talk to me. There is no secret. Okay, you almost got it. Let's try this again. There is no secret. What God can do, what He's done for others, He'll do the same for you. Look at somebody and say, I pressed my way to get here. Now, you talking cute, but get your preacher's voice to say, I press my way to get here. Now show me a praise tonight when you press your way. After all you've been through, you still got joy. You still got a praise. Is there anybody here that can testify, I still got my joy and I still got my praise? I got somebody to tell me, I still got my joy and my praise. Hallelujah. All in the name of Jesus, we come to tell Him thank you for what you have done tonight. Now, God, move in this place. Have your way in this place. Move like you've never been before. Let the atmosphere for people tonight. We the world in this place. You won't do what you said you won't do before. Cut right down the name of Jesus. Cut right down the name of Jesus. Have your way right now in this place. As we say it's done. Now put those hands together and give God a real praise. Come on, give him a real praise. One more time, throw your arms around somebody and say, I feel good, I feel good. Come on, throw your arms around somebody. I feel good, good, good. Come on. I feel good. Y'all sound like y'all got a cold. Makes me feel good. Come on. Oh, I feel good, good, good. I feel. Come on, Kanja, help me, help me, help me. Oh, I feel good, good, good. Come on, I feel. Put those hands together.
I'm singing for my Jesus, that makes me feel good, good.
Oh, I feel good, good, good.
Oh, I feel good, oh yes, my Lord. There is something now singing for my Jesus, that makes me feel good, good. Well, sometimes up, sometimes down, almost never to the ground. There is something now singing for my Jesus that makes me feel good, good. Oh, I feel good, good, good. I feel good, oh yes, my Lord. There is something now singing for my Jesus that makes me feel good, good, good.
God bless you. You may be seated. Amen. Amen. I want to make sure you didn't fall asleep. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. Let somebody say, I feel good, I feel good, I feel good. Amen. Come on, get ready. Praise dances. I want y'all now. Amen. We got some speakers that are in the house. They bless us. Let's give it up. Amen. For Dr. Mobley. Amen. And for Dr. Kemp. Come on, Maranatha, welcome him in tonight. Amen, amen. 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 I'm going to ask the liturgical dances to come very quickly. Amen. And then from there, we're going to get right into it. Amen. So you can get back home in your bed. Amen. 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 I know some of you almost messed up tonight. Said I wasn't going to go. There's something in you. Push you to come out. How many of you know that something had to push you to come out? Amen. Come on, praise dancers. Amen. Amen. All right, get those glasses so you can see. Come on.
Praise him upon the sounding cymbals. Let everything that have breath praise the Lord.
Thank you. Hallelujah. Let us thank our people really quickly. Amen. Let's give, first of all, what Father said before I call on our lecture today. Let's give Mother Water a hand, our Christian Education That's our responsibility to do what we can do. Amen. Just let you know we love you and support you. Amen. Amen. At this time, we're going to call. He's no stranger to Maranatha. Amen. I told you every time you look around, look like you see him. Amen. That's my homeboy. Amen. And so he's here tonight, amen, to give us our lecture on tonight. Let us put our hands together as we receive our main lecture tonight. Let's give it up for Carleton Mobley as he comes in his own way. Come on. Come on. Let's make some noise for him. Come on. Come on. We can do better than that. One more time, let us put our hands together for Jesus. Amen. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Maranatha, good evening. Grace and peace unto you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And certainly we're here and we thank God for Jesus, who's the head of my life, and for his presence in this place tonight. And certainly we thank God for Reverend Dr. Camp, who's here tonight, as the main preacher, and certainly to your pastor, my friend and brother, as you know. Come on, give it up and put your hands together. Amen, for this great young man of God, what he's doing in the city of Maranatha and in the village of Queens and in the state of New York and in the nation of America and all over the world. Amen. Amen. God is blessing him and blessing you through him. Amen. And come on, Maranatha, give yourselves a hand. Amen. Another Ward for this Christian Congress, this Christian education experience, as I know you're preparing to go to in St. Louis. And God has blessed you with a new bus.
Amen.
Amen. And I believe, as I said Sunday, there's more on the way. God is going to continue to bless you as you prepare. But tonight, my task tonight is just to lecture, so because you have a preacher. And I thank God. Now, this is how you know your boy really love you, right? Now, this is a sign that they really love you. He allowed Lemuel Mobley, I call him my cousin because, you know, we have the same last name, to come and set the house on fire last night. And then he closed it out with Dr. Camp, and he put me right in between. I'm so glad I'm going before Camp get up, and I'm so glad I didn't have to go come after Lemuel last night. Amen. I'm right between them, and so I'm in a good spot, and all I got to do is lecture. Amen. Which means all I have to do is talk a little bit, teach you a little something, and hopefully you get something. Amen. So let's go into this, because I know I have a time, and I don't want to keep you here all night, because we have a preacher. But when your pastor called and asked me to come, he wanted really to dive into the importance of your Christian education and why it's so important that you would have it. And so as we're about to go into this, let me just have a quick word of prayer. But turn your Bibles to Mark chapter 1. I know you're doing the Timothy thing, but I want you to look at something about Jesus and his teaching and how he taught and how he was prepared to teach on tonight. Mark chapter 1, verse 21 to 22. Mark chapter 1, verse 21 to 22. When you have it, say, I have the word. Very quickly it says, and he went and took Capernaum, and straightway on the Sabbath day he entered into the synagogue, and he did what? Somebody say, taught. And they were astonished. Somebody astonished at his doctrine. For he taught, someone says taught. Them as one that has, someone says authority. And not as the scribes. You may be seated. He went to Capernaum straightway the Sabbath day. He entered the synagogue and he taught. And they were astonished at his doctrine. For he taught as one who had authority. And not as the scribes. Father, we thank you for this moment in time. We have the lecture tonight. We pray your spirit would touch and that you would have your way with me tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm sure I don't have to tell you this because Maranatha, you're a very bright, very smart church.
Thank you, sir.
But I do know that you know this, that education is very important.
Yes.
Education in its broadest sense is the means through which people pass on their knowledge from one generation to the next. Though some of our education is acquired through experiences that forms the way we think, feel, or act, much of our technical education, the more narrowed and detailed scope of knowledge that turns a jackleg into an expert, is the formal process by which mankind deliberately passes on its accumulated knowledge, its skills, its customs, and values from one generation to the next. So in this education, then, is preparation for many, many things. It's preparation for building a sound economic future. It's preparation for developing a well-rounded intellect. It's preparation for performing at your peak in your chosen career. It's preparation for making good life-altering decisions. But most importantly, education is preparation for wise leadership. Somebody say wise leadership.
Wise leadership.
Without wise leadership, cities, counties, states, nations, and even churches would fail and would ultimately fall. So my brothers and sisters, there are statistics that may surprise you. 50% of a person's knowledge is acquired by the age of 5 and 80% by the age of 8. That ought to make some parents and children sit up and pay attention. Not just here and now, but the next time you're in the classroom. Parents who think that elementary school is not that important are the ones who end up with troubled teenagers who act out because they can't keep up. And we all need to understand what the Japanese and Chinese already know, that education is critical in the formative years. And so you need education because education helps your child and even helps you as an adult perform and informs you, but it also helps you to be able to communicate your ideas. Be able to come across and tell people your ideas is important to understand that. As it is then and it is now, communication is everything in your education. Because if you could communicate your ideas, your passions, or your knowledge to another, you are an educator. And even more importantly, you are a leader. But what does it take to be a great leader? And for the best example, we have only to look at Jesus, as we read, who embodied in these two simple verses of scripture from the book of Mark. He gives us the perfect outline of the qualities of a great leader. Jesus entered the city of Capernaum on the Sabbath day, and immediately he begins to shake things up a bit with a straightforward style of leadership. What qualities do you see in this great leader? First of all, somebody say Jesus was accomplished. That's the first thing. He was accomplished. I don't know if you know this, but in ancient times, no man could enter the synagogue and teach unless he had academically mastered the scriptures. The scribes who led the congregants into worship were an elite group of teachers who came from the tribe of Levi. And all the depth, sophistication, and consistency in their teaching points to the fact that there had to have been a mechanism in place for the formal standardized education of these elite men in ancient Israel. And that word scribe is the English translation for the Greek word grammarites, which means students of the scriptures. So scribes were men whose primary occupation was writing out copies of the Jewish scriptures and teaching the people what the religious law said. And scholars today, they still argue that even for the brightest student in ancient Israel, their knowledge required years of audience training. They had to master far more than the simple 22-letter linear Hebrew alphabet, which would have easily been passed on from father to son in early Jewish home. So if you ever tried to read a book, the book of Leviticus and Deuteronomy, you know what I mean, because these scribes were charged to interpret every line of the Torah, the first five books of Moses, Genesis through Deuteronomy, and the scrolls from the major and the minor prophets with perfect accuracy. So you have to take your education very seriously. Look at your neighbor and say, you got to take it seriously. So the fact that Jesus entered the synagogue, walked up to the front of the room, and began to teach the Mosaic law with perfect accuracy meant that he was an accomplished student at the scriptures. Many Christians have questioned whether Jesus had unfair advantage in education through some supernatural transfer of his heavenly father's genius, but most theologians agree that was not the case. As our Savior operating in the flesh, Jesus had to develop his mind the same way students need to develop their minds today, one lesson at a time. But Jesus was not your average student. He made the scriptures his primary focus for the first 30 years of his life. And I can imagine his earthly father, Joseph, watching Jesus read in the corner of their workshop in between carpentry jobs and wondering about the intensity of Jesus' study habits. And it probably reminded Joseph of the time when he and his wife were frantically looking for Jesus over a Passover celebration, only to find him confounding the rabbis in the temple at Jerusalem while he was the age of 12. Jesus was always an intense student, and that's because Jesus was striving for excellence. Somebody say excellence. See, he needed to be a proficient student of his Heavenly Father's covenant relationship with Israel, not just in the spirit, but in the flesh as well. So he was striving to be an accomplished leader. Somebody say accomplished leader. And so we find here that Jesus was what we call accomplished. But here's the second thing. Jesus was also astounding. Somebody say astounding. See what it says in the beginning of verse 22. The scribes were astounded by Jesus. Can't you hear the buzz in the room when he began to talk? Isn't this the carpenter's son? I don't recall him ever being chosen for the official position of a scribe. Right. Who appointed him to overstep his bounds and come in here and teach us? And yet, as they listened, they were amazed by his knowledge. I come to discover that when you put yourself into study and you begin to grow up, I tell young people all the time, it's okay to be the smartest one in your group. It's okay to be well studied, because we have this idea, especially our millennials, that getting money and getting paid and getting that paper is more important than getting that education, and they're dropping out of schools everywhere. But it's okay to have knowledge. Somebody said have knowledge. In fact, Hosea said, my people are destroyed because of lack of knowledge. So if I can take a bit of spiritual license here, I'd imagine that Jesus quoted the entire 5 books of the law without so much as glancing down at the scrolls. Jesus was a master of the laws that his father had given Moses during Israel's wilderness journey. He feared no questions from the scribes because he could answer them all with an instant recall. They never heard Jesus say in response to one of their questions, I'll get back to you on that. The thieves and the vows of the law rolled off his tongue in perfect eloquence, but he didn't stop here. Jesus would not only quote the law, but he also dared to interpret the law and explain it, its heavenly intent in the lives of God's people. That's what great leaders do. They astound their peers with the depth of their knowledge. And I come to tell you, you don't have to be a preacher to be astounding. You don't have to be a preacher and go to seminary. All you got to do is study to show yourself approved unto God. A workman needeth not to be ashamed to rightly divide the word of truth. God just isn't speaking to a preacher, even though Paul was talking to Timothy, but he's speaking to all of us, because we have to be, and I failed to tell you this, but I tagged the title of this thing. Here's what we have to be. We have to be, this is the weight of your witness as to how much you know who God is and how to defend the word of God that we believe in. Look at your neighbor and say, you got to be astounding. Not only do you have to be accomplished, but you have to be astounding. Here's the last and final thing I want to say. Jesus also was authoritative. Somebody say authoritative. How much time I got, Doc? I think I went about 11 minutes. I'm about done. He was authoritative. The verse says that Jesus taught with authority. Somebody say authority. The most interesting part about his reference to authority is that the rest of the scribes had none. It's an amazing thing. You can get up in front of folks and be as confident you want, put your hand in your pocket, don't look down at the scrolls like they had to do, and speak with authority. Amen. That's somebody that's well studied. Look at your neighbor and say, you got to be well studied. Yeah, that's why you get amazed when you hear preachers get up here and do what they do, because they put their head in the books. And I believe that some of you can tell when preachers don't put their head in the books, because they're not speaking with authority. The scribes couldn't speak with authority because they had none. Scribes were only permitted to learn what had been passed down to them from other scribes as the correct interpretation of the law. They were trusted professional experts who could judge individually disputed cases by recalling the appropriate Jewish law, but they dared not create new laws. This was forbidden. But here, standing before them, was a man who seemed to speak as one who had authority, who spoke as though he had a personal relationship with God of Abraham and Isaac. And that's how God wants us to speak. And the reason we have to study, the reason we need to put our heads in the books, and the reason we need to understand who God is that we have to have the word of God. David says, hide thy word in my heart. Not just so I won't sin against you, but I need to know who you are. In fact, we told in Ezekiel and even in Jeremiah that God told Ezekiel to eat this scroll and put it in your belly. And Ezekiel said, it was like honey to me in my belly. We need the word of God in us so we can be a witness for God. It's amazing because when our brothers do go to jail, they run into a lot of Muslim brothers. And the Muslim brothers seem to take real study and interest in what they're learning. But the Christian brother can't defend what they believe because they ain't got enough word on the inside of them. My brothers and sisters, we must study to show ourselves approved. But when we also need to be a sound accomplished. We need to be astounding, but we also need to have authority and stand flat-footed, be able to tell somebody about the goodness of Jesus without being afraid of that we don't know everything. Because you don't know everything, but if you take time to study, you will know something. Finally, we need to be authoritative. The weight of your witness will be based upon your confidence in your relationship with Jesus Christ. And when you get out there to witness to others about the saving grace of Jesus Christ, don't be timid, don't be bashful, or shy. You have the backing of Jesus Christ as your Savior, but you also know you have this word in your heart and in your mind and in your spirit to use in order to stand there to be astounding, accomplished, and authoritative. Touch your neighbor and tell them, I am astounding, I am accomplished, and I am authoritative. This is why we study. Come on, put your hands together, give God praise in the house. Thank you. Come on, you can do better than that. That was powerful. Come on, come on. Amen, amen.
So, Maranatha, I just got one question to ask you after that. Who's on the Lord's side? Who's on the Lord's side? Hallelujah. Come on, just put your hands together here tonight. Thank you.
standing to your feet once again. Amen. I know it's good exercise. The bones got a wiggle. Amen. 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 We thank you once again, Dr. Mobley, for that. Oh my God. Thank you. Thank you. They're just like a pickable counter when we talk about when we over the phone, man. Amen. And so we thank God for you, and we thank God for being here tonight. Look at somebody and say, neighbor, there's a preacher in the house. Okay, I told you, make sure you clear your throat. Touch somebody and say, there's a preacher in the house. All right. Amen. And we are so happy to have Dr. Camp all the way from Brooklyn. Amen. Amen. I'm just so delighted that he pushed this way, amen, to be here tonight. I know he had many things to do, but God is faithful and God is good. And when we called him, amen, he was able to come. And we talk so much, even though I haven't even really met Kent like that. But young preachers talk about him so well.
All right.
And it's so good to hear so many good things about Dr. Camp. My good friend Dr. Kevin Williams in Brooklyn, that now pastors, always talks highly of Dr. Camp. I know through the years, you know, our pastor that was here before me, Dr. Mixon. And we are just so delighted. He's going to come in his own way. I told him he's home. Do what he has to do. If you want to run, run. If you want to do whatever you want to do, he's home. We are just so happy to hear that he's here with us tonight. So let's show him a good Maranatha welcome as he gets ready to pour into us tonight. Lift your hands towards heaven and say, bread of heaven. Come on. Bread of heaven. Feed me till I want no more. Bread of heaven. Feed me till I want no more. Now make some noise for him as the man of God comes. The Reverend Dr. Larry Camp from Brooklyn, New York, Bethlehem Baptist Church. Come on, receive him as he comes. Eternal God, our Father, we are thankful that you have allowed us to stand in your presence.
Yes, Lord.
And in the presence of the redeemed, I pray that you would anoint us afresh.
Yes, Lord.
To give us clarity of mind and speech.
Yes, Lord.
I pray that my thoughts would be your thoughts and my words your words. Do not let me see anything that would cause you shame. Hide me behind the cross. Let less of me be visualized and more of you realized. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
And the people of God said amen again.
Amen.
I certainly honored your honored pastor, Dr. Beach and Boo. This is my very first time here.
Amen.
And
amen.
Such a wonderful
welcome.
Spirit.
Welcome.
It's good to be here, and I want to thank your pastor for the invitation to share. And certainly to my colleague, Dr. Carleton Mobley, who I spent time with last week as well.
Yes.
And certainly to the Director of Christian Education, Sister Ward, and all of those who are connected to Christian education. It is an honor, and I'm humbled to be here on tonight. And I want to thank God for you and the Maranatha people. You're such wonderful spirit and vibrant in every way. And I thank you so much.
Bless you.
My wife of going on 34 years is with me tonight, Mrs. Lorraine. She's also one of our preachers, Minister Lorraine Hunter Camp. I asked that she would stand so you can see where my wife is. That is. Our middle daughter, Asia Lorraine. That's my middle daughter, Asia Lorraine. Our last seed, our last child, our youngest daughter, Nigel Elizabeth Camp, she will stand. Our oldest daughter, Nisha, she, of course, she's married. And so is Asia, she's getting married. We have our granddaughter with us as well.
just quoting up this, Zamira Barachel. It's a Hebrew name. And my oldest daughter, Anisha, her and her husband moved to Canton, Georgia. I don't know where that's at. But he is 40 miles out of Atlanta. And so we came here, but we also came to be a blessing to this church as well. So we did not come empty-handed. We want to be a blessing to you. I want to thank Carleton Mobley for the wonderful lecture that he gave us on this evening. Brothers and sisters, I'm just going to make an attempt at a scripture. Dr. Harry S. Wright, who used to pastor the Cornerstone Baptist Church, used to say, I want to pull up an umbrella right here. And it is found in the Gospel of Luke chapter 5, verse 8. The Gospel of Luke chapter 5, verse 8. I would be reading from the New International Version. The Gospel according to Luke. We always say that we've all been trained to say the Gospel of Luke. It is actually the Gospel according, as an eyewitness account, according to Luke. And so, and that's what we say when we talk to other people about things. Say, according to Brother So-and-so, he said. So it's the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 5, verse 8. When Simon Peter saw this, he fell at Jesus' knees and said, go away from me, Lord, I am a sinful man. For he and all his companions were astonished at the catch of the fish they had taken. God's word is blessed.
Amen. Amen.
I want to talk from this thought, brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, the confessions of a weary fisherman. The confessions of a weary fisherman. The interesting thing about this text is that it shows disciples at labor or an attempt to work. And Jesus assigns himself to them where he has them to work to be fulfillment of their particular jobs that they do. For instance, there's no sense in calling someone a fisherman if they don't fish.
Amen. Come on.
And there's no sense calling any individual a laborer when they don't labor. My mother used to, we grew up in the Williamsburg Projects in Brooklyn. We didn't grow up in on any house, or we didn't have any porch. Santa Claus did not come down the chimney. He came through the incinerator.
Come on,
help somebody.
My mother, every year, there used to be gardens outside of the projects, and of course they would compete on each block. In the Williamsburg projects, there was four blocks: block one, block two, block three, block four. We lived on block four. And what she used to do is that she would always plant, and she would get herself down on her knees and to cultivate the ground so plants could grow. She spent hours on her knees cultivating the ground, and she would move one dirt aside, and anything, the dirt that was on the surface had used up its time, and she would move it out of the way, and she would dig down deep in the surface of the dirt so that the dirt that had been watered so much would be brought up to the surface. And while it would be brought up to the surface, she would then in turn would dig and dig and dig. My mother won numerous prizes, but the reason why she was such a good gardener is because she loved what she did. And my daughter Asia doesn't remember this, but when my wife and I dropped Asia off, she would have Asia in the ground, digging and planting. And Asia at that time was really enjoying it. And of course, my mother died at the tender age of 52 years of age, so she passed. But she did know Asia, and didn't know about Nigel, and then of course didn't know my oldest daughter, Nisha, as well. So she would dig that ground. So the Bible talks about the harvest is plentiful, which means there's a whole lot out there. But the laborers, They're few. Now, I know y'all don't have this in Maranatha churches, but there are churches that I know, including the one that I am, is that we've had people for so many years that got so consumed in entitlement, they forgot that they were laborers. They became intoxicated with their own selves by drinking out of their own self-righteousness. And as a result of that, they became drunk, not overnight, but for a period of time. And when one is drunk over a period of time, it is hard to recover. Now, I'm sure I have witnesses in the house that can testify to the fact that when we drank a lot, and we would lay on the bed, and the walls would move. I wish I had a black church this evening. And the walls would move. We vowed to God that we were never going to do it again. And so as a result of that, we would wake up with what they would refer to as a hangover. Because even though the liquor was still in our system, we were just not that intoxicated. So what has happened over the course of the years in all of our churches, and not Maranatha, but some of our churches, in which people have drunk so much of themselves, they have not awakened from the hangover. And by not being awakened from the hangover, are too tired to labor. Because to labor, you have to have a steady hand. You gotta know what you're doing, you know. You gotta have a steady hand. We don't want doctors or surgeons operating on us after they came from the watering hole. Because I'm on the table, and if you're gonna cut me, I need to know that your hand is straight. And the hands are not always straight. And so Jesus challenges the disciples, and he says to them, he sees the boat, and he knows that Simon Peter is part of the boat. He says, now, what I want y'all to do is push from the shore. This is very imperative, Maranatha, because here's what happens, is that in the church, we stay on the shore. But we don't push out into the deep. And over the course of time is that whenever we do things in our church, we draw from the same well that's inside of the church without thinking of the fertile ground that's outside of the church. So it's this place, just the word called Genesaret, which is called, because of its beauty and fertility, is called the Paradise of Galilee. And as a result of that, is that we fail to realize that there's something more outside beyond our walls. And we become so consumed with ourselves that we forget what our labor is supposed to be. Now, I know the ushers would say, well, I do my labor, I usher on Sunday. And I know that the deacons would say, well, I do my work because I deacon on Sunday and I'm here tonight. I know the trustees would say, I do my financial responsibility. I know that the liturgical dancers say, well, I'm dancing on Sunday. But you just can't have just one day to get high on. I'm talking about righteous high. I'm talking about righteous high. There has to be a sense of a consistency to labor in God's word. But then there's something else too. This happens to all of us. This happens to all of us. No matter how long we've been in Christ Jesus, we do get weary.
Amen.
Because of the labor that takes place. And the reason why we get weary is that we feel we don't see any results. In all of the churches all over the country, I'm not talking about the mega churches. I'm talking about the local church, which, by the way, people will return to. You don't see it yet, but what's happening, the mega church, is nothing wrong with them. But the mega churches are a big production. And in the production, people from the local church go to the mega church, not to bring back to help the local church, but to get high off the mega church and don't give their labor to the local church. So everybody be flying off to the Allen's Women's Conference, and they They be flying up to these different conferences and all of that. They be saying, what kind of time yet? They're waving their hands on a women's conference and don't lift up their hands in their own church. They don't love their own church. They just love the theater of what they see at the conference. But they got to labor every once in a while. Labor means to sweat. It means to use your muscles. It means to use your brains. It means to use everything that you have, all for the sake of Christ with love. But a choir sings, the choir ought not to do us no favor. And the only way for a choir to tear up the house, you got to tear up rehearsal. You gotta work the Holy Ghost in rehearsal. Because we too busy waiting for 11 o'clock, but you got to work it at rehearsal. Because what you do at rehearsal is going to overflow on Sunday. Check this out. Check this out now. Anybody talks about Michael Jordan, Kobe Bryant, LeBron? I love Kawhi Leonard. I'm not a San Antonio Spurs at all, but I love Kawhi Leonard. I'm going to tell you why I love Kawhi Leonard. The reason why I love Kawhi Leonard, when he first came into the league, they said he couldn't shoot.
That's right.
But what he did in the offseason was to work on his game. He was a defensive guy, and now they call him the best two-way player in the league. I can defend the best player, and I can shoot the lights out. There are some people that are one-way Christians that don't know how to play both ends of the floor. They're so busy being offensive, they don't know how to be defensive. But I'm a big Kawhi, and the other thing I like about Kawhi Leonard is that when he makes a big shot, he don't pound his chest.
That's right.
He don't scream. If you cut on the television, you don't know whether San Antonio is winning or losing because of his stoic expression. And so here in the household of faith is that sometimes we want to be recognized all over the place. We want to be recognized all over the place. No tithing, no prayer, no devotion, no Sunday school. But not in Maranatha, though, but their church is all right. Jesus says, y'all pull out from the shore. You're staying too close to the ground. I need you to work the water. Because I know what you can do on the ground. But I need you to work the water. Work the water. That means you got to have the boat balanced. And you got to have the nets cleaned. Because I need for you to work the water. You got to work the water. Everybody can't work the water. Everybody too busy working the ground. But everybody ain't working the water. Work the water means if there's an advantage of working the water. First of all, when the breeze comes, you inhale the freshness of the water. See, you don't get that on the ground. But you get that in the water. And then when the water comes, it also, God creates a balance for the water sometimes. But he also has you to work the water just in case it becomes rocky. I don't want you to fear because I control the water. So he says, now get yourself away from the ground. I need for y'all to launch out into the deep and get yourself some water. So here's what Peter does. Peter is fishing. From can't see in the morning, can't see at night. He's fishing. He's a disciple. He's Jesus' boy. But he's tired. And he's weary. And he's exhausted. Get out there, Peter. Get your net. Let down his net. And he comes and he says to Jesus in this way, Master, we toiled all night long. And we ain't caught nothing. That's his confession. He's saying, at least I tried. But I ain't caught nothing. Sometimes we leave our net on one side too long.
All right. Amen. Wow.
There's some other areas to fish in.
Yeah.
Now out there in Coney Island, Rockaways, they get up 4 o'clock in the morning. And the reason why they get up 4 o'clock in the morning because they think they can catch a bite.
Right.
But sometimes the fish know that your line has been there the same time. So they swim away from the area.
Yeah.
And this was Peter's frustration. The fish just wasn't biting. Jesus says, take your net, throw it over. I mean, he didn't even say nothing difficult. Throw it over on the other side.
That's right.
Maranatha.
Wow.
You can't get disappointed because of some Sunday morning services look scattered. You here.
Amen. Amen.
And if you here, it really don't matter who's not here.
Right.
Now, what I have said to the people at the Bethlehem Church is that now when Resurrection Sunday comes, make sure you dictate the worship experience. Because what happens is that guests come in the house.
Wow.
Family come in the house that you ain't seen in 15 years.
Wow.
And they come in the house and then we diminish our worship because we want to act cute in front of the crowd. And the crowd that's not coming back. So what happens is that crowd that's coming on Easter Sunday morning is dictating to how we worship. And the people of God ought to be able to say, whether it's your neighbor, whether it's your friend, or whether it's your family member, you got to be able to say with a loud voice, this is the day that the Lord has made, and we're going to rejoice and be glad up in here. And so we dictate, so the people of God ought to dictate the worship. Once you dictate the worship, those who came for the fashion show, forget about what they had on. And after a while, they begin to feel what you feel. And even if they don't join, they still got to go away feeling different than what they came in because you dictated the worship experience. So what happened? Here's what happened. Here's what happened. And I'm almost done. What happened was is that Peter, they all had caught, they let their nets down, and they caught all this fish. Uh-huh. The problem was Peter was talking for himself, but there were some other folks there ready to work as well.
Yeah.
So the net got so heavy.
Yeah.
And then, so here's the thing. It's important in every church that one person don't do it all. Now, y'all want to know what happened on the Mount of Transfiguration? I'm going to tell you what happened. You remember when Peter, always Peter, right? They get up there on that mountain, and Jesus is talking to Moses and Elijah, and they have a real dialogue on the mountain. Now, the only reason why I could really have a really theological problem with calling the Mount of Transfiguration is that it sounds like the mountain gets co-billing with Jesus.
Wow.
And the reality is, wherever Jesus is, he gets to be the glorified one. And so what happened is that Peter got so excited about being up there. He had an idea. Why don't we make three tabernacles, NIV says shelters. One for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. Here's the problem. Had the Holy Ghost not come in and said, this is my beloved son, whom I well please, hear ye him, right? And if you and I would have been talking about those three tabernacles today, Peter would have said, but that was my idea.
Yes, sir.
Wow. Yes, sir.
Wow.
Every one of us are on a journey, but each one of us are going to be replaced.
Amen.
Now, in the black church, we don't like to hear that.
Yes, sir.
It's true. Because we act like we got stock in it. You know, like it's Wall Street, like we invested stock in it.
He's good.
And after a while, when we invest in it so much, we think it belongs to us.
Come on, man. Come on. Say, preach.
This is God's house. Paying rent.
Amen.
Now, I don't want y'all to get upset because I want y'all to know we all on this journey. Now, Pastor Beecham, he's the pastor, right?
Amen.
He proclaims. He gives guidance and vision. But then there are those, as he gives guidance, one net, vision, another net, proclamation, another net. Other folks supposed to come in, grab the net, and while he got the fish in the net, he ought not to be pulling by himself. And those who are pulling ought to have a boat to put the fish on. But the fish ain't just to go to your house. It's supposed to fill this house. So the fish, if I can use it, the fish is type of the glory of the Lord. Because it was so heavy, one person couldn't pull it by themselves. You act like you don't believe what I'm saying. The Bible says that when Solomon prayed a prayer, the priest couldn't get in the place because the glory of the Lord filled the temple. And there comes a point that everybody got to pull so that when the house gets full, everybody gets to participate in it, but the glory goes to God.
So, that's what Peter says. Here's what he says. Caught the mob. He says to Jesus, he's so ashamed, brother deacons. He's so ashamed what he said. We toiled all night long. We didn't catch nothing. And when all that fish came in, he said, Master, go away from me. Go away from me. Because I didn't believe it enough.
That's right. Come on.
Because all I was doing was thinking about my exhaustion and my tiredness. Nobody gets a pass when they're born into this world. And that's why it really bothers me that we who are of African descent, don't tell me about your half Indian self and your Choctaw and Cherokee and Sioux and Blackfoot. I'm talking about when we came from the shores of the African continent. Now, the reason why some of us are light is because we've been mixed up all over the place. But I declare, when they see you walk into a room, they don't see Choctaw or Sioux or Cherokee. What they see is somebody that is of African descent. And when you consider where the Lord has brought us and we still standing, I declare unto you, they whipped us, they chained us, they enslaved us, they used our women as belly warmers, they used our men, and they used every kind of thing, but we still here. We still built the best schools. We still were here. We still able to survive every situation because the glory of the Lord rests on us. And so, and I know probably they probably have it out here. There's a challenge in Brooklyn called gentrification. And what the intent is not to come for the houses that you own, but for the church property. And I said that the people of God ought to stand firm. This is God's house. We stand here till he tells us to go someplace else. But this is God's house. The reason why this block and this street is doing so well, because Maranatha is here. The reason why your job becomes blessed, because you are there. The reason why your family becomes successful, because you are here. There ought to be a praise in the house. I said there ought to be a praise in the house. When I speak of the goodness of Jesus and all that he's done for me, my soul cries out, hallelujah.
So they talk about in that song, keep your lamps trimmed and burning. Keep your nets clean. I said, wash your nets. Put your nets together and wash your nets. Because God's got some deep waters for you. The question is, are you willing to pull back from the shore and launch out into the deep?
So that's where we are. And I think the late Dr. Garvin Taylor said that the black church is the soul of America.
Amen. Come on now. Help us.
It's the soul of America. And I can't forget. See, do you ever think about why you're blessed?
I know many of you will say, well, I had a praying mother.
Amen.
And a praying grandmother.
Amen.
Those prayers go back further than that.
Amen.
On the transatlantic slave trade, while our men and women lied in the boat, surrounded by feces and urine and menstruation, didn't know what was going to happen to them, I believe those Africans were on their back saying, please don't let this happen to my children and to free them from the arms of oppression. Don't let this happen to my son. Don't let this happen to my daughter. And when they dropped those slaves off in 1619 in Jamestown, Virginia, God was right there. You may not have seen it, but God was right there. And when we went to Reconstruction, God was right there. And when we went to segregation, God was right there. Right there. And so when you get weary, I want to say to you, Maranatha, and the friends of Maranatha, guests, don't get weary. There comes a point where you will, but go into deep waters. And to let you know you don't walk alone, just get some good companions that will help you to pull your nets. Woo! Just repeat after me, pull my net, Lord. Send me some help to pull my nets. Pull my net in Christian education. Pull my net in the Sunday school. Pull my net on the usher board. Pull my net on the leaders of the church. Pull my net in the community. Pull my net and bring it to shore. And God will do it. Yes, he will. And I remember when Ludacris sang this song. Ludacris sang this song. Went to my hotel, got drunk as hell, and woke up in the morning with a story to tell. Wake up the next morning with a story to tell. But he's the rock of my salvation. He's my, he holds me up in every situation. He is my leaning post. If I'm about to fall, God lifts me up to a greater capacity to live. And that's who we serve. And as Pastor Mobley said, it's not enough to be shouters and praisers. You got to know what you're shouting about. Finally, have you ever, and this happens to people who study, have you ever read a passage of scripture at your dining room table or wherever, and a caption caught you so much that you had to get up and walk around for a couple of minutes? No organ's playing. Ain't no drama playing, but what the word does, it invokes excitement into your spirit. And so when you study God's word, you become passionate with the word of God, and the word of God makes love to you. God's word makes love to you. You don't feel the same way. But you got to have your hands up. With my hands lifted up. And my heart filled with praise. To God be the glory. For the great things he has done.
Wow. Very quickly, let somebody say, neighbor, do you know Jesus Christ? Come on, touch him again and say, do you know Jesus Christ? Come on, may there be one tonight.
With my hands lifted up. With my mouth filled with praise.
Come on, Tante, help me.
With a heart of thanksgiving,
I will bless
thee, O Lord.
I will bless thee, O Lord.
I will bless thee, O Lord.
Come on.
I will bless thee, O Lord.
Come on.
Thanksgiving.
May there be one. May there be one tonight. Harden not your heart. God bless you.
In my heart of thanksgiving, I will bless thee, oh Lord.
Brother, can you give me one table?
Oh, I will bless thee, oh Lord.
Come on, church, sing it out.
I will bless thee, oh Lord.
Let me get two people to hold two plates. I'm gonna do it right tonight.
I will bless thee, oh Lord. Oh, I will bless thee, oh Lord. I will bless thee, oh Lord.
With my heart, yeah.
With the heart of thanksgiving.
I will bless thee, oh Lord. One more time. Oh, I will bless thee, oh Lord. I will bless thee, oh Lord.
With a heart of thanksgiving,
I will bless thee, oh Lord. Come on, let's give God a hand of praise. Come on. Amen. Amen. We almost out of here. Listen, tonight, amen. Those of you that had your envelopes on last night, we're going to continue even on to Sunday. If you didn't get our envelope, we're asking for a special seed of $20 or more that can bless Christian education. Like I said, I got a commitment from 10 pastors already, plus I already know from others on the outside that's going to help Pastor Beecham ship our Sunday school department off the right way. Amen. Amen. So tonight, we have the speaker's plates on the left and the right. Amen. Tonight, now, you heard some words tonight. Am I right? Come on. I said you heard some words tonight. You got two for the price of one. Amen, somebody. Amen. And so tonight, these preachers exegete, they went into the text, they pulled from the text, they went verse from verse, they spit it out, amen, so you can go back home and study for your own. Amen, somebody. Amen. And so we thank God for all these preachers tonight. And so we want to bless them tonight. I already know what I'm going to do personally, but tonight we want to bless them. Then the middle is for the church. Amen. But tonight, let's not forget our speakers. Amen. If you have your envelopes, you can put them in the church basket tonight if you want to tonight. Or you don't have it tonight, you can wait until Sunday. If you need an envelope, we'll kindly, you have some more ushers back there? Amen. Okay. If you need an envelope, we'll kindly get you one. Amen. So you can be a blessing. Let us stand on our feet. Amen. Very quickly. Amen. Be directed by the ushers as they go now.
Thank you. Maranatha Church, we want to make a donation to Christian Education Award. We got a check here for $200 and we're extra. So we want to be a blessing to you. Thank you. Amen. That's right. Keep it coming. Keep it coming. Stretch your hands towards the offering. Father, we thank you now for all of these kingdom builders, and we thank you for all these givers tonight. Now we just thank you for what you're going to do. Have your way. And we say it's done in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Deacons, help us move that table. Amen. Amen. Look at somebody and say, neighbor, I had a good night. I had a good time tonight. Come on, touch them and say, I had a good time tonight. Now, could you just do me one favor? Look at someone and say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Come on, get your preacher's voice. Say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Help me do one thing. Help me get up. Amen. We want to say to, once again, to, we just want to salute, amen, First Lady Camp, amen. Let's give her a good God bless you. And Pastor Camp and his daughters. Now, Maranatha, I need you to do this one more time. Make these gospel preachers. Come on, let them feel it. Come on, let them feel it. Let them all feel it. Amen. Right now, to give yourself a hand, for pressing your way through. Y'all don't know, man. Me and Mobley and Vicky were praying for y'all tonight to press your way through. You saw the rain. You said, oh, Lord, there it goes. You know, Baptist folks don't like to get wet now. You know, amen. Amen. But I know at the city of Maranatha, God has blessed us. God has blessed us.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Dr. Camp, I don't think I'm going to look at that text no other way before. My God. That was lovely, man. That was lovely. Wow. 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 I'm going to keep on hanging out in Brooklyn. Amen. Good things happen in Brooklyn. Amen. 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 Thank you, amen, Dr. Camp, for who you are, for your legacy, for all that you have done in Brooklyn. Amen. Amen. And for your good reputation. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Maranatha, I love you. Thank you for pressing your way. Love you so much. Love you so much. Get on the telephone and tell somebody what they missed tonight. Come on, get on the telephone and tell somebody what they missed. Because they missed some treatment tonight. Tonight, trust me. You missed it, man. You missed it. You missed it. You missed it. Doc, what you think? We're going to discuss, right? Some good stuff, right? Amen. 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 Let's give a Reverend Kennedy. He's a Christian education fanatic. Amen. We call him Dr. Cannon. Yep. Amen. Christian fanatic. Amen. Amen. So God, we bless all of those of you that come to Bible study that really come out, and we give you the praise. We just thank God for you that do so much here at Maranatha. 12 o'clock Tuesday, you come out at 7 o'clock. Then Wednesday night, you come out again. Amen. Amen. God is blessing this house. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. God is blessing this house. Amen. We thank God. At this time, I'm going to ask Dr. Camp to come and give us final words and final benediction. Amen.
Maranatha, you made it so easy for me to preach. I love your receptive spirit. You know, my wife is my best friend. I don't say that, I mean, just to be saying, I mean, I really do, because most of the time she's right anyway. But when I was, before, as Carleton Mobley was lecturing, my wife texted me, she said, make sure you stick to the subject. So, and every once in a while, you need to have that little, you know, thing thrown your way. Because what happens in preaching, and I know, that Reverend Carleton Mobley and Pastor Petrie can tell you, sometimes you go to a certain church, you get overwhelmed just by the people's presence and spirit, that you get a little bit off track. Now sometimes you gotta know when to get your exit, because there's a running joke that preachers have, that they should miss the exit. So when somebody said, where's the next exit? He said, 55 miles. So I have to know when to get my exit. I want Maranatha to know, along with your pastor, I want to bring y'all to Bethlehem, and I want y'all to come, I really do. And I want to bring y'all for a Sunday afternoon so we can feed y'all, really. Because I think y'all have a tremendous spirit, and I want you to come, and I'm going to create something, because what happens is that I have a pastor's anniversary, but it's one day. And the reason why it's one day is that because I wanted it to be one day, because I didn't want to tie out my people. But let me tell you the reason why. The reason why I did the one day is because I went before our officers at our church, and I said, take a certain amount of money out that would cover 52 weeks, and then present that at the anniversary, a morning service and then an afternoon service. So what happens is, and then my tithe is taken out of my church, you know, for the whole year. It's taken out for the whole year in advance. But I have to take the envelope and still put it in the tithing box so people know that I'm getting. But the money's already been taken out. So what happens is that when we do the pastor's anniversary, you know, the highlight is I may have maybe one service a month, but I didn't want to tie my people out, and I didn't want to tie me out.
Wow.
And sometimes when I had Jesse Bottoms upstate who helped me out with that, by they take a certain amount of money out and then they give me that, and the people give even more. Because sometimes for your pastor, if he has more than one service, basically the faithful few come out and they're giving all of the time.
Right.
So as they're giving all of the time, I just went before my congregation, they thought about it, they looked at it, and they said it made sense. So now with only one anniversary, I have one anniversary one day, I have to create services. Because I want to be able to have more fellowships. So that's what I mean by that when I said I have to create something. So that's what I want you to understand. And, you know, listen, not that I'm trying to do anything, man, but that's something y'all consider too. Your pastor, you'd be surprised what pressure it takes off of the people of God to give so much, where you can bless your pastor in advance. And now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power both now and forever. And the people of God all say together.
Amen.
I was waiting on it, man. Ah.
Come and shake Dr. Kim's hand and Dr. Bobby's hand. Please don't not leave here without shaking the preacher's hand. Let him know how much it is. Come on, Deacon. Deacon, help him come down. Amen. Please begin.